So this week, we launched a new segment on Market Edge, Breakthrough, with a focus on passions, entrepreneurship, and breakthroughs, whether you're in one or chasing after one. This segment aims to provide you information and inspiration on how you, by investing in the country, can invest in your own future and lead a richer life. This segment runs every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. In case you ever wonder, in the busy of our days, exactly how you're loved by me, I think you'll be amazed. My favorite line from one of my favorite children's books. Our next breakthrough story is a children's book author. She's actually got two upcoming titles, When an Elephant Hears No, which hits the shelves next year in January, and When a Rhino Has to Wait, slated for a 2025 release. Dazzle Nang, thank you so much for joining us this morning. Hi Dazzle, good to see you.
Mimi, thank you for having me. It's so wonderful to be here.
Wonderful to have you. I can feel the energy, you know? When you write children's books, it has to be all positive and all bright and sunny. But I want to start with this. First of all, it still takes that long to get published. I mean, 2024, 2025, even for children's books that I imagine would be 15 to 20 pages long with 500 to 1,000 words.
So it's actually 32 pages, and mm-hmm. it's 500 words or less usually. So for this one, we have around, I think it's above 300. So I just think of it like, as a parent, it's really reassuring to me that so much thought and care go into these books. And also we give a lot of time, not just to the illustrators, of course, because that's, you're illustrating every page, everything is art. But also for the writers, for the authors. One of my favorite anecdotes is for this or for Rhino, we had a whole conversation in the margins of the Word document on a single word. It was like, you, are we going to take this out? Are we going to leave it? So there is a lot of thought and care that goes into it.
Huge, huge respect for your mastery of words. Simple enough to be understood and yet not overly simplistic that they lose meaning. I mean, you have to be pitch perfect writing a kid lit, right?
Absolutely.
Harder, you think, to write for kids rather than writing for adults?
Okay, so I can't speak for adult writing, right? But the tricky thing about writing for kids is that so you have a double market. You have your kid audience and you have your adult reader, typically a parent or a teacher. And your story has to appeal to both simultaneously. It has to be a good experience for both. And like you said, you are putting all the elements of a story, all of that into, you're squeezing it into so many pages, and you have a very, very competitive market. So because people think that writing picture books is easy, so many people are trying to do it, and you really have to stand out.
Dazzle, I'm guilty. I actually thought this was super easy because when I read my kids' books, they were so simple. But after page one, I was like, no, this is hard. This is way harder than writing the news. But I'm very curious, how did you find yourself doing what you do? Did you always want to be an author for children's books or picture books?
So like many picture book authors and illustrators, it started when I was reading to my kids, because it's just that magic of seeing their world expand and feeling things with them. And also as a writer, since I have been a writer in many of my jobs, I was very fascinated with how this format has evolved. Like when I was a kid, it was all fairy tales and storybooks. And now you see just this breadth of topics and difficult themes that are now made accessible to kids, both in fiction and nonfiction. Mm-hmm. So past year, so many picture book biographies came out, and you have kid-lit creators who are just playing with the elements of this. You have a very dynamic breaking of the fourth wall. You have a dragon. You can have a dragon, you know, burning a hole through your book. You can rock a character to sleep. There are wordless picture books. There are picture books. There's a picture book without words. So it's just really, really fascinating. And I wanted to be part of that and to make my mark, leave my legacy there.
And Dazzle, how do you make sure that the difficult themes that a simple children's book are actually understood by the readers, by kids? Do you have like a psychologist who goes over the story or the words that you use? Or do you try them out with your own kids?
I think I told you this offline, my kids are my harshest critics. But for the difficult themes, actually, there are things for the really sensitive ones, there are sensitivity readers. There are people who provide that sort of service. But for the rest, that it also works for you that you have an adult reading to the child. So kids are just so smart, and they are so curious, and they ask the best questions. So you do have to leave space for that. So for me, like as an author, I have to leave space for the illustrator to tell their own story, to add their own layers. And the best picture books are actually quite layered. So when you have you can have a very, very, very big theme, and it's condensed into something so simple. So one of my favorite books is actually Corey Dorifeld's The Rabbit Listened, and it goes in so few words. It goes through so many themes and emotions, and at the end of the day, it's about empathy. Mm-hmm. And it was done by just this rabbit not saying anything, sitting beside the child.
Oh my goodness, my goodness. Sounds like a complex, concept that you have to explain to a kid. Dazzle, I know that you're also a copywriter for brands. So you do copywriting for brands. You're an author of picture books, kids' books. How do these two professions, the two callings interact?
I don't like them too, actually. sometimes I tell my friends, one day I'm writing about antifungal creams, and the next day I'm writing about, an elephant throwing a tantrum. So I do need that space in between, and that's part of the self-care of creatives.
And you mentioned earlier how your kids are your harshest critics. What's been the harshest thing your kid has ever said or asked? Craziest question they've asked about your stories or your books?
The worst thing is them walking out in the middle of me reading it to them. That really is just testament to what the illustrator provides. Because mm-hmm. as the author, I write art notes, and that's mm-hmm. just not as powerful. I like the interplay of words and illustration, because sometimes your illustration can be telling a totally different story mm-hmm. from your.
Do you get narrative. To choose the artist who will do the illustration?
So it depends on the publisher. My publisher was kind enough to really involve me in the process. Ah. They're very collaborative. So they gave me a list, and I got to say I got to give my input. And super luckily, Australia said, yes, she is fantastic. She's also a storyboard artist. So the expressions of my characters that she brought to life, they're just so animated. And it's really fun. It's you can see from the cover, the elephant gets into so much trouble.
Without giving too much away, Dazzle, what's your process? I mean, how do you decide that this is going to be the concept and these are the characters, that I'm going to work with an elephant or a rhino? How do you do that? And how long does it usually take you to conceptualize and complete the story?
That's the interesting thing is that it's different for each one. So usually you start with an idea that just gives you that spark. You're excited to write about it. It's a seed that grows in your mind. But as to how long it takes for the process, so for these two, this one and Rhino actually started as a giraffe. And then because I had it was about patience, you have a character that can't sit still. And my publisher said, we already have a giraffe book. I don't know if I can say this, but they were saying that, can you change it to a rhino? Because we wanted to be rushing and ramming, charging all the time. And I was like, well, let me try. Sure. So I did. And that's how that worked out. But sometimes you write your first draft. It can be this one I wrote overnight. Huh. I did. And also rhino. So I wrote overnight, and there are some that just take me weeks to write, and they're not even that good in the end, so, and you have your critique partners to tell you that. So for me, that's an important part of the process. I have critique partners who tell me, very honestly their feedback.
Mm-hmm. And final question, Dazzle, there's a proverbial saying or expression about penniless writers. I'm pretty sure a lot of our viewers are wondering, is that still the case today, or has this become a very lucrative business? You don't have to give us exact figures, but give us a sense. Is this good? Does it pay well?
It really depends on, there's a lot of subjectivity in this industry, because you're, and luck, actually. That's why you can make your own luck, because you have to have the right manuscript land on the right editor's desk at the right time. So some will tell you yes, others will tell you, you know, it's still true, it still holds true. That's why you do have the, a lot of kidlit creators have other things, like we're multi-hyphenates and all that. But for many, the like what you get out of it is your dream coming true. And in terms of investment, it's not a lot. So you don't have a lot of cash out. You take a few classes, you you know, enroll in a few memberships, and you know, you can just make it happen through your internet and
But the dream coming true, I imagine, is priceless. Dazzle,
absolutely.
Thank you so much for sharing such an inspiring and full of energy vibe this morning. Thank you for being a breakthrough. I look forward to getting a copy of that book when it comes out next year in 2025.
All right. Thank you, Mimi.
See you soon.